Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our February Benedictine Conversation. My name is Dawn Carrillo. I am the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of Saint Scholastica here in Duluth. So we give you a very warm welcome. We're so happy you're here with us tonight. The format for the evening will be like this. We're going to have this conversation, our guest with myself. So at any point, if you want to send in questions or comments, you can send them in by the chat function on the bottom of your screen, and I'll be tending to that, watching for any of your comments. You might want to switch to speaker view. Those of you who are participants might want to switch to speaker view. It might give you a better sense of the conversation flow and so forth. So welcome once again. And I also want to welcome our wonderful guest. Father Albert is a Franciscan friar, writer, preacher, retreat leader in both Catholic and Protestant churches, and he's also a teacher of spiritual formation and spiritual direction. He joined the Franciscan Order in 1976 and was ordained priest in 1983. He received a Ph.D. in Historical Theology from Fordham University. In 1990, he's hosted talk shows on the relevant radio network, and he was also a missionary to mainland China for more than 11 years, and I'm sure he'll speak to that this evening. And now he is a full-time itinerant preacher in the tradition of St. Francis of Assisi, and offering retreats to clergy and religious, as well as preaching parish missions. In fact, the other day he told me that after tomorrow, I believe it is, that he's on the road for the remainder of Lent, giving retreats, parish missions, etc. Father Albert, thank you for being here with us. Welcome.
Thank you, Dawn, and my goodness gracious, I can't believe you remembered all of that.
Well, it's a good thing we have internet. I can look up things like that. Yes, yes, wonderful. I'd like to start us with a little prayer as we begin this evening. Saint Benedict always said to start any endeavor that you want to bring to perfection, we should start with prayer. And I'm sure you would agree, Father Albert. So we pray. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is error, truth. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Father Albert, we heard a bit about your professional and ministerial life as I introduced you a minute ago, but I'm wondering if we could start out our conversation, if you could just tell us how, when, why did you become interested in the work of spirituality?
Well, before we even go there, Dawn, I need to say something, and that is because you mentioned about how Saint Benedict says everything should begin with prayer. I'm a little bit now, I feel a little bit stilted, because Saint Benedict, if I'm not mistaken, in chapter 7 of his rule, he says to us, you should never laugh in the monastery. And I'm a person of joy. And so if it's true that not laughing is one of those steps of humility, I'm afraid that your Benedictine viewers might have a little bit of a problem with tonight. But having said all that, I'm a great, great lover of Saint Benedict, because he's really a powerhouse. He's a powerhouse in the history of Christian spirituality. And he's one of the his great insight into the history of Christian spirituality was his whole thing of ora et labora, work and prayer. And so he was really great, challenging us to offer that balance. Anyway, to answer your question about how did I get interested in spirituality? You know, let me tell you something, Dawn. Ever since, as we say, I was born and raised in New Orleans, Louisiana, and ever since I was knee-high to a duck, I always wanted to be a priest, and I was always interested in spirituality, and I always wanted to be a missionary to mainland China. As a matter of fact, my mother, may she rest in peace, she used to always say the story. She told me on the day of my ordination, she pushed me into a corner of the reception. During the reception, she pushed me into a corner, kind of cornered me. Mama never called me by my name, Albert. She always called me by my nickname, Sugar Pie. And she said to me, Sugar Pie, I knew you were always going to be a priest. And I looked at her and I said, Mama, how did you in fact know I was going to be a priest? She said, because you came out of my womb and the doctor slapped your bare behind. And right away you gasped and said, let us begin in the name of the Father. My mother was a compulsive liar and she was a great comedian. But I'll never forget it when she told me that. But anyway, all of my life, I've always wanted to be a friar. When I was thinking about entering religious life and going on for priesthood, I didn't even think about any other religious orders. And I think that was because my sister was a poor Clare nun in New Orleans. We always had Franciscan friars hanging around our house, eating my mother's food and drinking my daddy's bourbon. And so I think that's where I kind of just, I thought, these friars, these are great people. They're ordinary people. But where, you know, what always interests me, and I don't know where this came from, I always, for as long as I can remember, wanted to be a missionary to the people of mainland China. I can still remember, and I wrote in my book, Catching Fire, Becoming Flame, I even wrote in there, I can remember in July of 1970, watching the evening news with Walter Cronkite. Mm-hmm. I'm showing my age. I'm going to be 68 years old next month, so I'm showing my age. But I can remember watching the evening news with Walter Cronkite. And the news, I think it might have ended with Marian Old Bishop James Walsh, who had been the longest imprisoned Catholic clergyman in mainland China and Shanghai. And he was walking to freedom over the Lowu Bridge from what was then called Canton, now called Guangzhou, and he was walking across the bridge from Canton to freedom into Hong Kong. And I can remember, Dawn, watching that and thinking, that's what I want to do. That's me. I want to be that. And then, 30 years later, I'm standing on that very bridge. The Franciscan Order had asked if there were any Franciscans in the world. At that time, there were 17,500 of us. They were asking for volunteers to go to mainland China to bring the Franciscan presence back to mainland China. I can remember standing on that same bridge that James Walsh, Archbishop James Walsh, had walked across. I can remember standing there thinking, maybe it's my time now to walk to the other side. Mm. And it was just a real moment of grace for me, just a real moment. So much of my life has been kind of characterized by my love for mainland China and the people. I would end up in mainland China. I went to Taiwan, the island of Taiwan, off the coast of mainland China for 2.5 years, where I studied the Chinese language. And then I was one of the first foreigners allowed to live in the town of Wuhan, which is, if you know anything about the coronavirus, right. They now think that's where the coronavirus originated. And then I moved up to the capital of Beijing, where I ended up living for 9 years. And then, unfortunately, one day I was beginning to be followed by what's called the Gong Anju, the Chinese security police in the capital of Beijing. My cover had been blown and I had to return to the United States for good. And that was in 2004. But, you know, I'm one of the lucky people in this world who get to say, I got to live my childhood dream. Anyway, you asked me about my interest in spirituality, and I didn't mean to go on there. But so spirituality, I don't know. It's always been something that I've loved. It's the waters that I swim in. And I'm always reading stuff on spirituality. And when I wrote the book, 10 years ago, Catching Fire, Becoming Flame, I tried to kind of put together my kind of understanding and synthesis of the spiritual life. And then in January, when Paraclete Press wanted to issue the 10th anniversary edition of the book, it gave me the opportunity to kind of fill in some cracks in the book that I thought were missing in the original edition. And it was also gave me the opportunity to kind of explain in a deeper way some of the original chapters.
Beautiful. Well, thank you for that. You know, I want to talk a little bit about this book, which for our participants out there, the full name of it is Catching Fire, Becoming Flame, A Guide for Spiritual Transformation. Mm-hmm. And this is a updated 10-year anniversary. Yes. In the book, you state that God is always trying to awaken a dormant soul and set it on fire with godly enthusiasm. Those are your words. I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about, you know, what might this look like in my life? How do I know when God is trying to awaken my soul that I may not even be aware was dormant? And I'm thinking too about people who aren't tuned in to anything, you know, like you have been your whole life with spirituality. There's a lot of people that go through life not even thinking about it. So what do you have to say about that? How is God awakening us?
Yes, well, let me deal with the second part of the question, which is the more challenging question. And that is for people who are not tuned in to the spiritual life. So what would it look like? How does God, the image that I love to use is, how does God come knocking on their soul? And I think I think any experience in my life that brings me joy, any experience of my in my life that moves me out of myself, any experience in my life where I just all of a sudden forget myself and say, wow. All of that's the experience of grace. That's the experience of God. Any experience of selflessness, where I move out of my ego, out of myself, that those are all ways that God comes knocking on the door of my heart. And the question for me is, am I going to open the door of my heart? Am I going to respond? And I can say, Dawn, that for people who are tuned into the spiritual life, that can be a very frightening experience, because if I'm tuned into the spiritual life and I feel God is knocking on the door of my heart, let's always remember, as the Old Testament says, God's a jealous God, and he's never content with the 10% I give him, the 50% I give him, the 80% I give him, the 90% I give him. He's never satisfied. So he's always knocking on the door of my heart in every situation of my life. That is why in chapter one of Catching Fire, Becoming Flame, I talk about how the awakening, how God kind of awakens us to the experience that he wants a deeper relationship with us. It's always occurring in my life. I mean, at age 67, he's still knocking on the door of my heart. I was just in a spiritual direction session last week with a woman. She's married 55 years, has had a wonderful life, five grown children, has a wonderful husband. And she's now all of a sudden coming to realize at age 55, after this marvelous life that she's had of authentic relationship with her husband, everything. She says, you know, Father, I feel like I've only given God 35%. And that's an awakening. That's another form of grace that God is always trying to awaken our awareness to what's going on in my life. And anything that moves me beyond myself, joy, love, peace, self-control, anything that moves me beyond myself is always an experience of God's grace. And this is how we experience it. And if I can go a little bit further, unless you want to ask me something else, if I can just go a little bit further, Dawn, this is why it's so important. I always like to tell people, your life is a megaphone through which God is speaking to you. So listen to your life, because in the experiences you have, in the people who come to you, in your deepest feelings, and in your most creative thoughts, God is trying to awaken you to a deeper experience of being in relationship with him. Listen to your life, because your life is a megaphone through which God is speaking. And what saddens me is some people just don't, they're not living with awareness. They're not living with mindfulness. Mm-hmm. And this is the whole challenge of the spiritual life, to live with awareness and mindfulness, to always be, you know, there's a wonderful image. Is it in the Gospel of Luke, that in that wonderful image that Luke describes Mary pondering things in her heart? Well, that's what we should be doing every day. Listen to your life, because this is how God communicates to us.
Yeah,
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to go
on. No, that's good. Because what you're bringing to mind is something I was going to ask a little later. I think about the people that aren't aware and the rest of us that may be aware, but are distracted, busy, etc. But in particular, the people that aren't aware of this, I'm thinking of a quote by Brother David Steindl-Rast, where he says, you know, if you say, I come alive with music, or I come alive when I'm gardening, that those are spiritual moments as part of your spirituality. For people, though, who are not tuned in, they aren't maybe not able to name that in the same way. And so my question is, why is it so hard? Why is it so hard for us?
Well, you know what, Dawn? If I had an answer to that, I would be as rich as the Jesuits. No offense to the Jesuits. I've had Jesuit education all my life. So no offense. But my point is, I think we tend to look for God in all the wrong places. We tend to look for God in all the religious places. But we are embodied human beings. This is what the incarnation is all about. Right. We all have a body. And so anything that moves me out of my body, out of myself, out of my ego, out of my selfishness, that's an experience of God. And unfortunately, most people just don't name it like as that, because we always want to put these heavy drapes on an experience of God. And we want to say, if you have an experience of God, this is how it has to be in the church, has to be look just like this. And that's your experience of God. And yet in our Christian tradition, in the spiritual and the mystical tradition, the mystical and Christian tradition has always said, God is found outside the box. Mm-hmm. I mean, think of the great mystic who was declared a doctor of the church, Hildegard of Bingham. And of course, St. Hildegard, I mean, she's like, she's seeing God in every aspect of everything. And it's not necessarily, what we would traditionally define as spiritual. So this is what the great tradition, the mystical tradition offers us, is this great wisdom that God is found in the ordinary.
Yeah.
In love, peace, joy, patience, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, what St. Paul calls the nine fruits of the Spirit. Mm. In Galatians chapter 5, those experiences are all experiences of God.
Mm-hmm. And certainly within the Benedictine and Franciscan tradition, that is about finding God in the ordinary, just like you're saying. You know, the other thing that's coming to mind for me, this is why Dostoevsky said, the world will be saved by beauty. Because what you're describing with these experiences, this moment of beauty, joy, different sorts of things like that, that pull us outside ourselves. Yeah.
I mean, this is what, I mean, any, I was just talking month ago. So I have a spiritual directee who is an avid fly fisher. And so he was saying to me, he was in the bayous of Louisiana doing his fly fishing. And I even said to him, you don't go fly fishing in the bayous of Louisiana. You're not going to catch anything. But he says, oh, you'd be surprised. Anyway, he was saying to me how there he is on his boat. He's alone. And just throwing the fly. And all of a sudden, he said, you know what? It was like I had this out-of-body experience. And I said to him, that's an experience of God. Anything that pulls us out, that's how God sets us on fire. And so I think from so many people, going back to your original question, so many people who aren't in tune with the spiritual life, they're not aware of the fact that all of these experiences of selflessness, of moving beyond myself, this is how God communicates to us, and this is how we experience the presence of God.
Thank you for that. Yeah. You talk in your book about each of us moving toward becoming a little Christ. And then going on, you go on to say that this life work of becoming a little Christ leads us to challenge institutional religion's insensitivity to the outcast and marginalized by becoming arsonists of divine love and compassion. First of all, I have to say that is just a beautiful quote. But I'm wondering if you could say more about this process of becoming a little Christ and how it leads us to this place of challenging insensitive structures.
Yeah, well, I mean, what else more can I say? It's just that I think that as the more and more we open ourselves up to the grace of God, and the more that we are willing to allow ourselves to be transformed, we do become more sensitive to how institutions are so rooted in policy, procedure, and paperwork that we forget that ministry is about people. I mean, this is what worries me so much. So many times I see people turned off and walk away from the institutional church because they don't have the right paperwork, or they don't live up to the policy, or they can't do the procedure. Well, nowhere in the Gospels does Jesus ask anybody for their baptismal certificate. Jesus is so focused on people and what they need. And so ministry, and I think as we grow in the spirit, hopefully as we grow in the spiritual life, and as we get our rough edges kind of taken away from us, we come to see that ministry in the spiritual life is not about policy, procedures, and paperwork. It's about people. It's about people. And the problem is, and this is the very sin of the Pharisees. The Pharisees promoted a form of spirituality that was cosmetic. Obey the law. We've got 613, what they call mitzvot. We've got 613 of these laws. You obey these laws, you're right with God. And Jesus comes along, and this is one of the things that was so challenging about Jesus, is he says, it's not about obedience. It's not about a cosmetic spirituality. It's about a cardiac spirituality, a spirituality of the heart, responding to whatever the person needs. And if the person needs something and it's the Sabbath, well, then you break the law of the Sabbath in order to heal the person. And of course, I think, let me kind of show my cards here, Dawn. I think this is part of the reason why a lot of people are uncomfortable with Pope Francis, because he's challenging us to get back to the cardiac spirituality of Jesus, to move beyond the cosmetic and go to the cardiac. And a lot of people are uncomfortable with that, because when you go to the cardiac, you now have to rely upon yourself and your own experience of God. And that's a little bit unsettling.
Scary.
To say the least.
Cardiac spirituality, that's a great. So, growing into this more cardiac spirituality, which is igniting the flame that you talk about in your book, igniting this flame, fanning it on. If we don't do that, you say in the book, we're like sleepwalkers. I love that image. Is there anything you'd add to that?
Yeah, because I think most of us, we go through life as sleepwalkers, totally unaware of how every moment of my day, God is trying to wake me up. You know, it's interesting because I love to talk about, let me tell you something, Dawn. I love to talk about living with mindfulness, living with awareness. And it's very interesting. I was just four months ago, I was in New Jersey giving a workshop on living with mindfulness. And one woman got up and she said, I am very uncomfortable with you using the words mindfulness and awareness. She said, you know, that sounds like Buddhism. That sounds like New Age spirituality. And I granted her that. So then I said to her, okay, I'll give you that. And I said, but let me tell you the way Jesus talks about it. I said, Jesus talks about being awake. And I said, in the first letter of Paul to Thessalonians, he talks about the importance of staying awake. And in the book of Revelation, it talks about the importance of staying awake. In the Jesuit tradition, they talk about being contemplatives in action, always living with awareness. In my Franciscan tradition, they talk about living with the spirit of prayer and devotion. It all means the same thing, whether you're talking about mindfulness, whether you're talking about awareness, or using Jesus' image of staying awake. In other words, be attentive to what's in front of you. And respond to what's in front of you, because when you respond to what's in front of you, you are responding to the will of God. And that's why in the book, Catching Fire, Becoming Flame, towards the very end, a chapter that I added was on living in the present moment. And in the Jesuit tradition, there's a great book that was, it's ascribed to the Jesuit Jean-Pierre de Caussade, Abandonment to Divine Providence. We now think he didn't write it, but whoever wrote it, they talk about the thing of that in the present moment, God reveals his will in the unmet need or required duty of the present moment. And that's living with awareness, that I'm always being attentive to what is God asking me right now. And so if I'm a mother and I've got a 3-month-old daughter and I just put her down for a nap and she suddenly wakes up, starts crying, well, what's the unmet need or the required duty? I pick her up, and then picking her up, I am in effect doing the will of God. This important thing of responding to the unmet need or required duty of the present moment. And I think, now I'm on a roll here, Dawn, so you have to shut me up. But I think this is what Jesus is talking about in the parable in Matthew chapter 25, the parable of the when the judgment of the world, when the Son of Man comes back and separates us like sheep from shepherds. And he says he says to the he says to the goats, he said, I was hungry, you thirsty, naked, you didn't clothe me. And they said, well, when did we see you do that?
Right.
And he said, whenever you did not do it to them, at least my brothers and my sisters, you did not do it to me. But then he turns to the sheep and he says, go to heaven, because I was hungry, you fed me, and I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. And of course, they're shocked, they're amazed. They say, when did we see you? And he says, whenever you did it to the least of my brothers or my sisters, you did it to me. In other words, respond to the unmet need or the required duty in front of you. Because in doing that, you're doing the will of God. And that's living with mindfulness. And that's what spiritual growth is all about. And I have now forgotten what you asked me. I mean, it's your question.
It was the sleepwalker question. But this is so interesting because when you put it the way you put it, it sounds maybe a little simple, even like, well, okay, that's easy enough to do, but it's not. It's not easy to do. It's not easy to stay attuned to the present moment.
Oh, you know what? Can I tell you, it was like, and I shouldn't say this because I shouldn't tell you the story because I was so grateful I did it. I just came back from the LA Congress. It's the largest annual gathering of Roman Catholics in the United States every year. They converge on Anaheim, California. I gave a talk there. And after my talk, I was answering questions. And then I looked at my watch and I had a priest picking me up at 12 noon to take me out to lunch. A good old friend of mine from Las Vegas, I've given like 4 parish missions at his parish. I'm going back there this year again. Anyway, so I'm trying to get out of the auditorium to go to my hotel room, change my clothes, to meet Father Jim. There's a 16-year-old kid in tears. And he comes up to me and he says, and it's like 10 minutes to 12. And he says, Father, can you hear my confession? Well, I'm embarrassed to say it, Dawn, but the only thing on my mind was getting back to the hotel room, changing my clothes, and going out with Father Jim. And yet there was something that said to me, you got to stay and hear this kid's confession. So I said, hang on for a second. So I pulled out my phone and I sent a text to Father Jim. And I said, I'm running late. Going to probably be like 30 minutes. Give me some time. And I sat down with this kid in the middle of this lobby, and I heard his confession, and it was like all of a sudden I realized this is what it's about. It's about allowing myself to be inconvenienced because God never makes an appointment. So we have to be willing to be awake, to live with awareness, live with mindfulness, and be willing to respond to whatever the unmet need or the required duty is of this present moment. And that's hard. It's hard for all of us. But
right.
Go ahead.
Oh no, I'm stuck on your phrase. God never makes an appointment. Wow. I mean,
it's true.
Yeah,
it's true.
Our lives are full of appointments.
Our lives are, and not only that, but I don't know about women, but especially for us men, we're control freaks. And so we want to have every moment of our day kind of regimented so we can say at the end of the day, this is what I've done. And we look at distractions, what we consider to be distractions. We look at what we consider to be distractions as kind of pains. And yet, this is where God's grace comes to us in our everyday lives. Mm. And so we need to kind of live with this kind of constant awareness, because God never makes an appointment. And on top of that, God always comes to us in disguise and as a surprise. And when I say that in my Southern accent, from being from New Orleans, it rhymes. God is a God of surprise and disguise. But when you say it in the Yankee accent, it hasn't quite worked. God is the God of disguise and surprise.
Yeah, I worked for some Franciscans in central Minnesota many years ago, and they talked to me about holy interruptions.
It's the same thing. And you know what? I mean, in your Benedictine tradition, it's pretty much the same thing when Benedict says in the rule to welcome everyone as Christ. Well, guess what? Not everybody who shows up at the monastery is your most wonderful guest to have. Right. And so God comes in surprise and disguise.
Wow. That's
why in the book, Catching Fire, Becoming Flame, in the 10th anniversary edition, one of the things that I thought was missing in the old edition was a whole chapter just on hospitality. And so I added a chapter on hospitality, and I ended it with Benedict's great little reminder, welcome everybody as Christ.
Right. I would just like to turn to our participants for a minute and invite you to send in any comments or questions that you have. I'll be watching that chat. Let's see. You make the statement in your book, Father Albert, that sooner or later, we all discover that restlessness comes into our lives for a profound purpose, so that we may begin a relationship with God. And restlessness, I know you flesh that out and talk about it in lots of different ways, and you use some examples. But my question for you is, do we really all come to this discovery?
I don't think we do. I think there are some people who they are, especially people in the midlife crisis or at midlife. I mean, this is why midlife is such a great, it's a grace, and it's also a real challenge, because before midlife, I'm climbing the ladder of success. And so I'm always trying to climb higher, and then midlife comes and I realize, my goodness gracious, my ladder is against the wrong wall, and I have to reorient my life. And that's when people begin the interior life. When they come to discover that it's not about outside of myself, but it's the great quote from Augustine of Hippo in the Confessions. You know, Augustine says, I searched for you outside. Where are you? Oh, Lord, oh, Lord. I kept looking for you, and then I discovered you were within. That's midlife wisdom. That's midlife wisdom. And so at midlife, we make that journey inside. Some people, unfortunately, because they don't have either the experience, the language, or whatever, they never make that. And so they keep going outside of themselves looking for something that's going to satisfy them. And they never realize that we only come to satisfy ourselves, as Augustine says in the first paragraph of the Augustines, in the Confessions, you've made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. But I mean, this is a real journey for all of us. And some people come to that wisdom at an early age. I'm thinking of if you have any Carmelites watching tonight, I'm thinking of John of the Cross. John of the Cross at the age of what? 24, 25, had this profound wisdom that 48-year-old Teresa of Avila asked John of the Cross to be her spiritual director. Well, Dawn, I would never ask a 24, 25-year-old priest to be my spiritual director. You got to be crazy. They might have the head knowledge, but they don't have the experience. But the fact that Teresa would ask John of the Cross to be her spiritual director says to me, John of the Cross must have come to that wisdom that very few people come at such an early age.
I want to turn to, just for a few minutes, you have a chapter, I don't remember right at the moment what it's called, but you discuss sin. You talk about
sin and imperfection.
Thank you. Sin and imperfection. And, you know, I really did appreciate your discussion on the difference between sin and imperfections or weaknesses. And then you go on to talk about, you use the parables of Jesus to really zero in on what sin actually is. And you state it as the parable suggesting that Jesus understands sin as a refusal to be transformed by God's fiery passion, you say. Can you help us understand that a little bit more?
Well, you know, as a priest, I'll be a priest for 40 years. And as a priest hearing confessions, everybody confesses imperfection. It's a person who will confess sin, confess imperfection. To commit a sin, you have to know it's a sin. You have to do it deliberately. And you have to do it in freedom. And what I find is that God is always calling me beyond myself. God is always calling me to a deeper relationship, with Him or with other people. So God is always trying to move me beyond myself. Whenever I refuse to do that, that is Jesus's understanding of sin. I refuse to be set on fire. I refuse to move beyond myself. And when you look at the parable, because Jesus, as I mentioned in the book, Catching Fire, Becoming Flame, Jesus uses the word sin, if I remember correctly, 7 times in the Gospels, but he never talks about what it is. He just uses the word. And so in order to get an understanding of Jesus's understanding of sin, you really have to kind of tease it out from the parables. And when you look at the parables, it's all about refusing to forgive, refusing to respond to the neighbor. I'm thinking of Lazarus and the rich young man. It's all about not allowing myself to grow. And so Jesus says, cut the tree down if it doesn't produce fruit next year. So Jesus's understanding of sin is all about this idea of not being willing to be set on fire, not being willing to move beyond myself. And I think that's the real reason, that's the real understanding of sin. It's cardiac. It's not cosmetic. Going back to what I said earlier.
Right.
And yet a lot of people are uncomfortable with that because as an average Catholic, I want to know I'm right with God or I'm wrong with God. And so when you now say that it's not about obedience, but it's about love, it's not about a cosmetic spirituality, but a cardiac spirituality, well, that gets a little bit gray. A little bit tight and dicey,
yeah.
But that is exactly what Jesus is calling us to.
Huh. You have a beautiful chapter toward the end on suffering, what suffering means, what to do with it. And you counsel us, you say that asking why when we are in a time of suffering, and you give this beautiful story of yourself and how you had asked that question for years and years and years, and you realized, okay, I'm asking the wrong question, that it's more about how we deal with it, how we move through suffering. So I was just wondering if you had any additional comments.
So real quick, because I'm watching the time, because I know we're running out of time. So the thing is, I highlight in the book, Catching Fire, Becoming Flame, I highlight how even scripture does not have a regular or a common understanding of why there is suffering.
Right.
When I looked at scripture, there were like seven different understandings of suffering, and each one is just as wacko as the other. And so when we try to ask a question, why am I experiencing the experience? Why is God calling me this, calling me to do this or accepting this? We end up giving really strange images of God. And I don't think the question is to ask, why am I doing it? The question is, how am I responding to it?
Mm-hmm.
And although I don't think I put it in the book, you know, the Jesuit, Teilhard de Chardin, probably said it best. Teilhard says, respond to suffering as though it were a loving energy. That suffering has a way of transforming us. Suffering has a way of kind of moving us into a deeper experience of life. Respond to it as though it were a loving energy. What I say in the book is, look at the Psalms, and the first thing to do is pray the psalm of regret. Yell at God. Complain to God. But then be aware of the fact, like Jesus did on the cross, my God, why have you abandoned me? So the prayer of lament is a legitimate prayer. But then also be aware of the fact that in the mystery of God, something's going on in me. That suffering, if I could be so bold, is really the other side of grace. Something's going on inside of me. I don't know what's causing it, God or whatever, but this is a grace in my, and this is why I think Teilhard de Chardin says, respond to it as though it were a loving energy. It's the other side of grace. You know, we tend to think of grace as the balloons, the popcorn, and the roses of the spiritual life. But there's a dark side to grace. There's an other side of grace that challenges us to open ourselves up to the experience of God. And that's the experience that most of us are not really aware of. I'm actually writing a book on this right now. So
I'm anxious for when that comes out. Yes. Okay. Probably our last question, and I'm really curious about this one. In the book, you write about several practices to keep us awake, to keep us mindful, whatever word you choose to use. And I was really taken with the many different traditions you drew from there. You had meditation, the Benedictine practice of Lectio Divina, the Jesuits examine of Saint Ignatius. So with several others also. But I'm wondering if you could tell us which one has been most fruitful for you.
I would love to. And the thing is, I always get criticized because I am sold on the Ignatian Examen. I am so long. I've been doing the Examen now for a good 12 years. At the end of every night, I look over my day and I say, most people think of the, let me just say this real quick. Most people confuse the Examen with an examination of conscience, and it's not. An examination of conscience is focused on me. I look at the past 10 hours and I say, how could I have been more loving? How could I have been more charitable? How could I have been more forgiving? That's an examination of conscience. It's focused on me. The Examen of Ignatius is focused on God. And I ask myself, over the past 10 hours, where was God? Where was God speaking to me? Where was God moving me beyond myself? Where was God challenging me to be more loving and forgiving? So the Examen, what I love about the Examen is it makes me aware of that my life is the megaphone through which God is speaking to me, as I mentioned earlier. Yeah. And so the Examen is not an examination of conscience, as some Jesuits will call it. It's the examination of consciousness. How conscious am I? How conscious am I of God's presence in my life and how God is moving in my life? And so for me, I found the Examen to be something that has just sensitized me more and more to the presence of God. Because I think in the end, that's what it's all about. It's all about living with awareness, how God comes to me in the ordinary, everyday events of my life. Because as I said earlier, God never makes an appointment. He always comes at an inconvenient time, and he always comes in the backwaters of a town like Bethlehem and Nazareth. So I need to be attentive. And that's what the Examen does. And I'm criticized for that because so oftentimes the Franciscans will say, you should not be promoting a Jesuit spiritual practice.
Oh, that's funny.
And it works for me. It works for me. And I always say to the Franciscans, well, Francis says we should never extinguish the spirit of prayer and devotion. Anyway, so that's what it is.
Yeah.
But we didn't get any questions or nothing, huh?
No one's come in with any questions. So, and we're about at our time. So I want to thank everyone for being here with us tonight. And I want to let you know that our center assistant will have this conversation up on our archive page if you want to watch it again, or if you want to send the link to friends or family and they can listen to this wonderful, wonderful conversation. We got a comment from Karen. She says, thank you very much. Thanks for your comment, Karen. You broke the ice. So I want to hand it back to you, Father Albert. And I'm wondering what words, thoughts, images, what do you want to leave us with tonight? What's our takeaway as we walk away from this?
Well, you know what? If there's one takeaway, and it's something that I tried to get in Catching Fire, Becoming Flame time and time again, is simply your life is a megaphone. So listen to your life. Listen to what people are saying to you. Listen to the situations you find yourself in. Listen to your most creative thoughts, your deepest feelings, because all of that is how God is trying to knock on the door of your heart and asking you to open the door more widely, not only to God's presence, but also to the sufferings and the challenges in the world. Because when all is said and done, it's all of God. And so anyway, when you and I can open ourselves up, to the unmet need, the required duty of the present moment, or whatever is going on in my life, this is how God speaks to us. And if I can just live with greater and greater mindfulness. So remember, there's nothing to get in the spiritual life. There's nothing to get. We simply need to become aware of what we already have. And that is God knocking on the door of our hearts.
That's beautiful. Beautiful. Deborah writes in, thank you. Jennifer writes, thank you. And Deborah said also, what an opportunity to listen, learn, contemplate, and then notice the godliness around us. So I just want to thank you so much for this tonight, Father Albert. This has been just precious and really fun conversation with you. I've enjoyed it so much.
John, thank you.
Yes, and on behalf of the Sisters of St. Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, to you and your community, Father Albert, and to everyone with us tonight, we wish you and your loved ones a continued meaningful Lenten journey. We hope to see you back for our next Benedictine Conversation in March. Thank you so much. This has just been such a pleasure. Thank you.
God bless. God bless.
Thank you, everybody.